Huawei MateBook 14S comes as a pretty serious upgrade for the MateBook 14 2020 AMD edition we got our hands on last year. As it clearly shows, Huawei has drastically improved the MateBook 14 series standards with its newest member. In fact, I feel like this one is really close to the X Pro model. Without further ado, let's examine the new stuff this model brings and let me explain why I consider MateBook 14S the best laptop for productivity. The display is a 14.2 Ltps with 3:2 aspect ratio, 2520x1680 resolution, 213 ppi with a 90Hz refresh rate and touchscreen capabilities. As I stated above, our current MateBook 14 seems so closely related to its MateBook X Pro sibling, I decided to begin this review in a slightly atypical fashion, meaning I will skip the design, build and ergonomics. So I will get straight to the point in terms of display features, because it's this field that sees the biggest changes. Naturally, we're talking about a 3:2 screen, and the Chinese manufacturer successfully understood the fact that productivity is of great importance during these rough days. We've been working mostly from home for almost 2 years under constant pressure. That's right, I'm talking about the need for productivity and efficiency. Similar to the X Pro, X2020 and even the 2020 MateBook 14, this 14S also features a gorgeous 3:2 ratio, meaning more information displayed vertically and more productivity. However, you will need to find another laptop if you want to watch movies properly. The resolution has been upgraded, reaching 2520x1680, and let me tell you about the real differences compared to the previous model. The current MateBook 14S has an Ltps display, which has several edges over the classic IPS type. The Ltps is developed by Tianma Microelectronics Co., a company that specializes in high-end displays, like AMOLED, for example. And since we're here, don't roll your eyes mumbling about the emergence of another Chinese company, just let me give you a bit of context. Tianma has a solid backstory. For instance, NEC LCD Technologies Ltd., a NEC subsidiary, alongside AVIC International Corporation, the Tianma mother company, established a joint venture, creating Tianma Japan 10 years ago. Oh, such a small world tech-wise. Ltps is the new hit, and I have proof. MateBook 14S follows the X Pro characteristics in terms of display. The Ltps low-temperature polysilicon has multiple benefits. Firstly, it keeps the same backlight brightness, but adds a higher brightness to the screen overall, unlike a classic IPS type. This means the backlight doesn't necessarily have to be that powerful, leading to lower power consumption. Secondly, I have noticed the brightness is evenly distributed across the entire display, and the measurements show a truly superior performance for this liquid crystal technology. If you take a closer look at these four scenarios, measurements taken during different brightness levels, meaning 470, 320, 190 and 100 nits, you will notice an overall difference of less than 5%. The biggest deviation, so to say, was spotted only at the 100 nits brightness level, a whopping 6%. And mind you, the results are astonishing considering the fact that the human eye simply cannot detect differences less than 10-15%. But these aren't the only qualities this panel offers. If you're familiar with Asus OLED panels, you might already know what I'm about to tell you. This current Ltps has a much better delta E compared to what an OLED has to offer. Even more, these values are indeed suitable for the graphic designers and video editors. There is one thing you need to be aware of. This is not a wide gamut display, so we are talking about an approximate 100% sRGB, 96% to be more precise. However, most photographers and video editors don't really need more than this 100% sRGB. Well, as long as you don't go full professional, in which case, one would need to shift the words Adobe RGB, DCI-P3 and so on. On the other hand, the color accuracy is really impressive, with an average delta E of under 1, so an exact 0.86. In addition, here's some other perks you get when using Huawei MateBook 14S. Increased brightness, up to 470 nits, works well even outdoors, if you take into account the fact that this is a touchscreen, and by that I mean a glossy panel. Good contrast, 1500:1, a nice black balance, not too high, not too low, and as an example we have a 0.24 nits black luminance when the display is set to 340 nits brightness. The advertised values are 400 nits max brightness, but our tests prove differently. Consequently, the display performs even better, and that's a really nice touch. Another addition to have blessed this 2021 laptop is the high refresh rate. That's right, the Tianma 14.2 panel reaches 90 Hz. To set the refresh rate, you just need to use Fn plus R. This allows you to switch between 60 Hz and 90 Hz. And believe me, the difference is really significant, especially if you pay attention when scrolling down a site. Oddly enough, Huawei advertises this high refresh rate as the perfect companion when watching movies. Well, that's the least suitable scenario to highlight the display's capabilities, but who am I to judge the manufacturer's wishes? Anyways, the combination of keys is a bit extra, because the display features a dynamic refresh rate. For context, watching a video full screen or leaving the laptop in standby will automatically switch the refresh rate to 60 Hz. Thanks to the Intel Display Refresh Rate switching, which can be found in Intel Graphics Command Center. But where's my webcam? Don't worry, it never left. It's still where you would expect it to be. Eventually, the MateBook 14S 720p webcam found its way back to its natural position on the upper edge of the screen. Yes, even with bezels so thin, 40mm on the sides and 6-7mm vertically, resulting in a 90% screen-to-body ratio full-view display, the camera can actually rest where it belongs. Well, it might have been the result of a more complex technology, namely laser soldering. To be honest, the initial placement under the key was a really funny and unique take, but people kept on complaining about the weird viewing angles during calls until Huawei finally gave them a listen. And here we are. Frankly, in terms of design, build and ergonomics, there's not much to talk about. The laptop maintains the lineup's trademark elements. A fully metallic case, aluminum-based alloy, which is tough, robust and does not bear the risk of bending. Same thing goes for the lid and the screen. It won't bend even if we pull open the laptop from the corner, although I don't recommend doing this. And this is helped by the display's glass layer as well. And this is how we get an extra rigid build. I couldn't help but notice the weird yet pleasant color variant of this model, spruce green. It's a softer and more delicate nuance in contrast to the eccentric emerald green sprayed over the MateBook X Pro 2020. For those of you who might get picky, Huawei offers another color variant, a classic, more traditional space gray. The panel itself has a wide opening angle of over 145 degrees, making it suitable for any scenario. Even though the panel does not feature that business-like 180 degrees angle, it still has an ergonomic angle, slightly better than the average laptops. The MateBook 14S is pretty heavy, around 1.43 kilograms. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. I really appreciate the solid metal case, a robust touchscreen, a tough and powerful cooling system, extremely helpful for the CPU the laptop hides, and last but not least, a generous battery, which we will discuss later. We are presented also with an extremely friendly keyboard, basically the keyboard everybody wishes for a productivity laptop. I instantly got used to it, there aren't any flaws, it's comfy and offers a generous 1.5mm keystroke. What's more, it also includes the soft landing option, which translates as scissor switches. The switches are directly bound to a rubber membrane, which lowers the strain of our fingers as we keep typing for longer periods. By doing so, the user can type faster, longer, enjoying a pleasant feedback. In terms of touchpad, the laptop has a pretty common one. It's really smooth and comfy, but forget the clicking part, because it requires some tough fingers, which will basically nullify the effort the keyboard makes to lower the strain of your fingers. In addition, it's very noisy, whereas a MacBook Air, for example, is basically dead silent. The keyboard is illuminated and its three levels are pretty relaxing, with minimal bleeding effects. I've come to like the power button. It is placed in a safe spot, so you won't accidentally press it, and it also integrates a fingerprint sensor. Allow me to bring forth the ordinary USB 3.2 Gen 1 Type-A legacy. It has become such a trend to copy the Apple model and equip laptops only with USB-C port, when the market is still flooded with USB-A based devices. I mean, it's not fun to hunt for adapters, trust me. I had no choice but to go hunting, else you wouldn't have had the aforementioned screen tests using our DataColor SpiderX Elite device. Obviously, this Huawei MateBook 14S configuration abides both to the 2021 standards and to the future movements. On the left, there are two Type-C ports supporting DisplayPort and even Thunderbolt 4 on certain MateBook 14S configurations, namely the i7 with 16GB of RAM, an HDMI port and a 3.5mm 2-in-1 audio jack. The Type-C port is also used for charging, and the laptop makes use of a 90W brick. I really hope 2022 sees the emergence of such chargers, which are ideal for portable and ultra-portable laptops. Here we are, folks! Surprisingly, for such a compact laptop like MateBook 14S, we are dealing with a standard voltage Intel Core i5-11300H CPU. As of RAM, we have a non-upgradable 16GB LPDDR4X dual-channel configuration. As expected, all the components are directly soldered onto the motherboard, the only exception being the upgradable SSD. For this configuration, the storage encompasses an NVMe M2 PCI Express Samsung SSD with 512GB. It's an extremely fast SSD, and the only reason for upgrading might be the need for more storage room. But let's get back to the CPU. Since this is a CPU with a TDP of 35W, the tests were worth my time. I wanted to see how well it performs and what effects does it have over the laptop case, how noisy the cooling system has to be in order to deal with this quite hungry fellow. The first impressions were remarkable. Zero throttling, not even after 15 consecutive Cinebench R15 tests done in a room with an average temperature of 22.5 degrees Celsius. I can safely argue that this is the first Intel i5 to avoid any possible throttling in Cinebench. Let's discuss the results as well. In single-core tests, the boost clock reached 4.4 GHz at 15 watts and 60 degrees Celsius. More specifically, this was the maximum temperature, while the CPU was using only 15 to 70% of its actual power. During the multi-core benchmarks, the cores remained clocked at 4 GHz. The base temperature shifted towards 80 degrees Celsius and the TDP stuck to 42-43 watts. The two cooling fans went a bit loud, generating around 43-44 decibels, which is quite acceptable when running benchmarks. In fact, this is a clear example of balance. Other manufacturers, for example, would have aimed for lower noise levels, which in turn would have led to poorer performance or throttling. I don't mind the noise at all, especially because that one was an act of heavy load. So for your average daily use, the laptop will be almost noiseless, reaching no more than 32 to 33 decibels. On top of that, not only did the CPU temperatures remain normal, but the chassis stayed cool as well. No more than 40 degrees Celsius were recording neither in the middle of the keyboard, usually the hottest area, nor above it. The hot areas are the evacuation grills under the hinge. Nothing unusual, as the slim laptops do not have side grills for hot air dissipation. What's in the images here? It's the first thermal recording before Cinebench R15 stress test, and the room temperature for reference. The results show a relatively cool laptop, as 40 degrees Celsius on the keyboard is nothing unusual for an ultrabook. Not even the bottom of the laptop seems to catch fire, but I recommend you don't use the laptop on your lap or do not cover the air grills. What's important is to interpret these results based on the CPU performance as well. For such a small laptop, the CPU is really powerful. For this, I compared its results in PC Mark 10 Extended with its predecessors, and the performance boost is remarkable. In other words, MateBook 14S outperforms even the AMD Ryzen 5 4600H powered MateBook 14 2020 by 10%. Once we set the refresh rate to 90Hz and the brightness level to 150 nits, an honorable 11 hours and 12 minutes were achieved during the Modern Office battery test. Considering the powerful H-series CPU and the 60Wh battery, Huawei has successfully managed to fully optimize the power consumption. This is the kind of laptop you can view as your all-day companion for your tasks, without worrying about running low on battery in case you left your charger at home. MateBook 14S has been a pleasant experience. Why? Well, because it's the first time I ever came across such a tough ultrabook. 15-20 consecutive Cinebench R15 tests and there was no sign of throttling. This is an extraordinary performance and to me, it raises the bar for its competitors. I changed my mind regarding ultrabooks, especially if you are talking about the inclusion of an Intel i5-11300H CPU. All in all, don't judge a book by its cover, although I did judge it considering Intel's fragile reputation. Huawei showed us that slim, solid, and powerful enough laptops can be produced. MateBook 14S is suitable for every office scenario possible without compromise. The lack of an OLED display in favor of LTPS, I couldn't care less. The colors are so accurate and evenly distributed. See, the excellent LTPS did a better job than a standard OLED. It's better to have such a display if you spend hours in front of the screen. Take that, add the low blue light hardware solution, and you have the perfect work ally. This was it for today. If you liked this video, please subscribe to our tiny but plucky channel.